as always, we welcome you to St. Ambrose. The Mass this morning is offered for our dear little friend, Adrian Borick. Before we begin Mass, let us all stand and turn to the back of our church and extend our arms toward Monsignor Mike. And he is celebrating his 49th anniversary. Congratulations, Monsignor Mike. Let us rise and be prepared for our opening song.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of God our Father, and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
Amen.
Well, today Father Albert is on his way to a conference to help him prepare himself to be a spiritual director, which is a kind of a specialized role in the church. He wants to be a good guide for other people and a good companion for them on their pilgrimage in life. And so he's going to spend the week there, coming back on Friday. So I invite you with me to lift him up in prayer during this week and to ask God to bless him in this undertaking. Repentance is the word that we used at the beginning of Lent to Jesus said, repent and believe in the good news. And that same word is all through today's scriptures. And something in me says, oh no, not again. But repentance has gotten kind of a bad name. It seems to us like it's scolding, but it's an invitation. Repentance is an invitation to the newness of life that Jesus invites us to. So let us prepare our hearts to celebrate the sacred mystery of the way the death and resurrection of Jesus is embodied in our own death and resurrection. Let's acknowledge our need for healing and forgiveness and repentance. Lord Jesus, you took on our human nature so that we might be clothed in your divine nature. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you were born of the Virgin Mary so that we might be reborn in you. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you lived the human life in a divine way so that we might live our human life in a divine way too. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Mercy, have mercy on us.
us pray. May your people exult forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter said to the people, "The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and denied in Pilate's presence when he had decided to release him. You denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked that a murderer be released to you. The author of life you put to death, but God raised him from the dead. Of this we are witnesses. Now I know, brothers, that you acted out of ignorance, just as your leaders did. But God has thus brought to fulfillment what he had announced beforehand through the mouths of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be wiped away." The word of the Lord.
Our response to the Lord's word is, "Lord, let your face shine on us." Lord, let your face shine on us. Lord, let your face shine on us. I call, the God of justice gave me answer. From anguish you release me. Have mercy and hear me.
Reading from the first letter of St. John. My children, I'm writing this to you so that you may not commit sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. His expiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for those of the whole world. The way we may be sure that we know him is to keep his commandments. Those who say, "I know him," but do not keep his commandments are liars, and the truth is not in them. But whoever keeps his word, the love of God is truly perfected in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. The two disciples recounted what had taken place on the way and how Jesus was made known to them in the breaking of bread. And while they were still speaking about this, he stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." But they were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. Then he said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do questions arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, because a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you can see I have." And as he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While they were still incredulous for joy and were amazed, he asked them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of baked fish. He took it and ate it in front of them. He said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and in the prophets and Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord. Peter said to the people, "You denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked that a murderer be released to you. The author of life you put to death, but God raised him from the dead. Of this we are witnesses. I know that you acted out of ignorance, just as your leaders did, but God has brought to fulfillment in this way what he had announced beforehand through the mouth of the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Therefore, repent." My children, I'm writing this to you so that you may not commit sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the Righteous One. He is expiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for those of the whole world. Expiation, redemption. He is redemption for our sins. He is the price of redeeming us from our sins. "Thus it is written," he said to them, "that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem and reaching all the way to parchment." Okay. Just for the heck of it, how many of you were baptized as infants? A good number of us. Well, whenever we were baptized, the invisible grace of the sacrament could not be detected by those who were present for the event. There was nothing to see or hear, nothing to taste or smell that would indicate the grace of the sacrament. But the grace of the sacrament of holy baptism began the transformation of the individual into a member, loving and beloved, of the communion of saints. By holy baptism, we became part of the communion of saints. And this is important because the movement of Christ in with regard to us is a unifying movement. The living body of Christ risen from death is what we have become and are becoming. This living body is the church. And in a way, the church is the goal of the transforming work of Christ. Jesus came into the world, the Gospel of John says, to gather into one all the scattered children of God. The church is the reality that binds all its members to Christ and so to one another, so that I belong to you and you belong to me and to one another. And not only in the present world, but also in the fullness of life that we call heaven. But while Jesus came to form us into one communion of faith in God and hope in his promises and love expressed in following his commandments, Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead specifically for you and for me. And by our baptism into him, he began the transformation of each of us into a deep and personal likeness to him. This likeness, the effect of the grace of baptism and of confirmation and of Holy Communion and of every other sacrament that we might have received, this likeness most gradually becomes visible as we gradually allow ourselves to be changed into his likeness. So what's happening within us, which is kind of invisible, nobody else can see what's going on in my mind and my heart, that begins to be expressed in the way we live, in the way we respond to the events of our life. Part of the likeness, I sort of think, unfortunately, is that we, like our Lord and Savior, must die in a way which is neither appealing nor painless. And before we die physically, most of us will spend quite a few years dying to a way of life that comes very naturally to us. It's the way that we sort of think of when we think of Adam and Eve. I know that we're not supposed to have that fruit, but Mr. Snake, you make it sound pretty good, so I think I'll have some of that. That's the natural way for us. Another aspect of the natural way is what I did for the first 50 years of my life, sort of assuming that it was my job in life to make myself happy. Not only is it impossible, it's stupid. Really, because if I was perfectly happy, what the heck would I need with you? But I do need you, and thank God you need me. Jesus' work in drawing me out of that, I will say, selfish focus into a loving and respectful communion of love gradually brings us together. And the dying that transformation requires is called repentance, a change of heart, a change of mind, and a point of view that enables us to see, for instance, that the peace of mutual respect is sweeter than the drama we sometimes prefer to stir up. This dying of repentance means quieting the insistence inside that urges us to cling to an old pattern, to keep smoking or drinking or bullying or gossiping, instead of letting the way of Jesus work in us. The purpose of repentance, therefore, is not only about having our past sins forgiven, but about the transformation of our lives, of ourselves, of our way of thinking and talking, our way of judging between right and wrong, between good and bad, between good and better, and learning to choose what is best. We must not be discouraged if, as we get closer to Jesus, there are more and more negative things for us to eliminate from our lives and more positive avenues that we should develop into. We shouldn't let that discourage us, because these challenges are clear signs that we are alive in Christ and getting to be more and more so. If we're not aware of our shortcomings, which has often been true of me, perhaps that's a time to ask for the help of our Lord, the help and the courage and the trust we need to die to ourselves and to live more and more fully in Him. Please join me in prayer here for a second or two. Lord Jesus, we lift up our hearts to You. We thank You for laying down Your life that we might take it up. We thank You for involving us in dying and rising and coming even here into the communion that will be, when perfect, heavenly. We thank You, Lord Jesus. Stay with us this day and forever. Amen. Let's stand together now and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with us. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. With confidence in the love of God for us that we have come to know in Jesus, let us bring these prayers.
For the church, may we proclaim the good news of Easter by our words and actions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the whole world, burdened with challenges, may peace and justice be known. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are suffering and in need of help, may they find comfort from loving caregivers. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, those who are alone and close to death, for medical personnel and research scientists, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who look to us for support, especially the poor, for the migrant concerns, and for all children separated from their parents, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish family, our sister parish, our beloved dead, and those in our prayer line, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we, as members of the Catholic Church in the Diocese of Kalamazoo, may unite in service to the Lord to support the educational, spiritual, pastoral, and charitable works of our diocese with generous gifts to the bishop's annual appeal. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Adrian Borak, for whom this Mass is celebrated, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving God, hear the prayers which we, your servants, make with confidence in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Spirit, cleansed by the blood of
Pray, dear sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant church, that you have given her cause for such great gladness. Grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed. Through him, the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and in his rising, the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of Jesus' death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and to minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, and Paul, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our beloved brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we too may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let our greeting now be a greeting of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
If you are receiving communion, please remain standing in your pew. If you are not receiving communion, please be seated. The priest will come to you. Please keep your nose and mouth covered except when consuming the host. At this time, please remember the sacred host should only be received in the hand.
Thank you.
On May 1st, 2021, our shepherd, Bishop Paul J. Bradley, celebrates his 50th anniversary of ordination to the priesthood. To help make this momentous anniversary special, we would love to surprise Bishop Bradley with notes and cards of thanksgiving and congratulations. Mail to Bishop Bradley, care of the Diocesan Pastoral Center. Do you like having a pre-celebrate Mass in the parish each weekend, or attend special Masses in the cathedral, such as the Diocesan Golden Wedding Anniversary Celebration, the Blue Mass, the Scout Mass, the Chrism Mass? Do you enjoy reading Southwest Michigan Catholic, the official magazine of the diocese? Have you used the services provided by Catholic Charities, the Karen Network, or the ARC? Bishop's Annual Appeal 2021 begins today and funds many ministries and programs within our diocese, including seminarian training, the Sanctity of the Human Person Office, training teachers and faith formation staff, evangelizing our youth and young adults, ministering to the homebound and incarcerated, and providing assistance to hurting families, the hungry, and homeless. During the past week, personal letters from the bishop were mailed to all registered families. Please prayerfully consider what you as an individual and as a family can pledge to support the educational, pastoral, and religious programs and services offered by our diocese. Then complete your pledge card and return it to the rectory office or through the Sunday collection. Your gift does make a difference. Our parish goals are 100% participation and $60,947. Your gift will help us accomplish both. Remember, no gift is too large or too small. Small bottles of holy water for use in the home are available in the vestibule. Please pick up a bottle and come for refill anytime. Thank you. Father Mike will recess as usual. Please remain in your seat until an usher releases your row, and this will begin from the rear. Please maintain social distancing as you exit the building, and please do not gather in small groups outside. Thank you.
Before we pray the prayer to St. Joseph, Father Albert asked me to say a word or two from him about the bishop's annual appeal. And his, Father Albert's, focus in this is that this is truly a way in which we support the work of Jesus, in our diocese in this area in Southwest Michigan. The bishop of Kalamazoo is charged with overseeing and promoting all of these services that we just heard listed there. And we support him in that. We provide what he needs to make that happen through the works of the diocese. So Father Albert would like us all to think about this bishop's annual appeal as really a connection between us and the work of Jesus that's going on here. We receive from it, and we support it, we give to it. Should we stand now? Let's pray the prayer together. Hail, guardian of the Redeemer, spouse of the Blessed Virgin Mary, to whom trusted his only Son. In you, Mary placed her trust. With you, Christ became man. Blessed Joseph, to us too, show yourself a father and guide us on the path of life. Obtain for us grace, mercy, and courage, and defend us from every evil. Amen. Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you were pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless us all, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us go in peace.
Thank you, God.